might know, and just say, as well as an independent senator, he's a human rights activist, was a recent presidential candidate, and has been credited with being almost single-handedly responsible for rehabilitating James Joyce in once disapproving Irish Army. He's taught Joyce to students at Trinity, written books, recorded extracts, and traveled the world performing solo shows, and done Trojan work promoting Joyce globally. He was one of the key people who saved number 35 Norbert George's Street from demolition. And it is now the James Joyce Centre, so fair play to you for that. And in this week, Dublin Gay Pride, we should also celebrate the massive impact David Norris has had on equality in Ireland. So we're delighted to welcome Senator David Norris to the Olivier Cornet Gallery today to read from you this Bloomsday week.
Thank you very much, Frederick. Ladies and gents, you are here assembled to hear why earth and heaven trembled because of the black and sinister acts of an Irish writer in foreign parts. He sent me a book 10 years ago. I read it 100 times or so, backwards and forwards, down and up to both the ends of a telescope. I printed it all to that very last word, but by the mercy of the Lord, the darkness in my mind was rent, and I seen the writer's foul intent. To show you for strictures, I don't give a button. I printed the poems of Mountainy Mutton and a play he wrote, you've read it, I'm sure, where they speak of bastard and booger and whore, and a play on the ward in Holy Paul and some woman's legs that I can't recall. Written by Muir, a genuine gent that lives on his property's 10%. I printed poets sad, silly and solemn. I printed Paulvig, what do you call him? I printed the great John Millicent Synge, who soars above in an angel's wing. In the playboy shifter, he pinched his flag from Monsell's manage of traveling bag. But I drawed the line at that bloody fella. He was over here dressed in Austrian yellow and spouting I tanned the air to O'Leary Curtis and John Wise Power and writing of Dublin dirty and dear in a manner no blackamoor printer could bear. Shush and onions! Do you think I'd print the name of the Wellington Monument, Sydney Parade, the Sandyville Town, Downs' Cakes and Williams' Jam? I'm damned if I will, I'm damned to blazes! Talk about Irish names and places. The one that's me upon me so little, not to mention Corley's Hole, which, ladies and gentlemen, you'll be relieved to learn is the geographical and not an anatomical location. It's a small bathing place on the north side of Dublin's Bull Wall. Now, Jerry Davis was mentioned, and I have very fond memories of Jerry. He used to dress up as Bloom, and he had a black three-piece suit and a bowler hat. He was just great. He was a bit of a devil. He hotwired a radio program I did in Australia and published it as a CD, which I thought was rather funny. But he was always around on Bloomsday, and he was a splendid man. Now, the two pieces I'm going to do, I'm going to do two fairly longish pieces. Hello, neighbour, woo! I have two neighbours here. Murren's over. There's Murren. And by the way, the presidential election was mentioned. I was sabotaged by the media in a very homophobic series of attacks. But thanks to Murren, I sued by the Tenant Bastards. And my bank balance from being a banker, well, the first one, you won't be surprised, I'm choosing my two favourite bits. If any of you have seen The Pride of Miss Jean Brodie, you remember when Maggie Smith said to school kids that she was teaching, girls, who is the greatest artist of all time? And they said, Leonardo da Vinci. And she said, no, you're wrong. It is Giotto, for his Mary's favourite. And there's an excellent way of selecting. Select your favourite. These are my two favourites. You won't be surprised to learn they are sex and violence. But the soft one, first of all, was a little bit of the violence. I'm going to do another one. I'm going to do three. I'll do the fire. Which is wonderful because earlier in the day at lunchtime, Leopold Bloom has a modest lunch consisting of a piece of gorgonzola cheese washed down by glass of good red burgundy wine. All fine and dandy at lunchtime, but by mid-afternoon this has established an effervescence in his intestines and he realises he's about to fart. He sees a woman coming along, he says, oh God, what am I going to do? So first of all he exercises severe sphincter control and then he pretends to be gazing intently into the curio shop where there is displayed the text of the speech of the dock by Robert Emmet, the young patriot. Now, I should say this takes place in an episode that's dedicated to music. Everything that happens is musical, and I think it's appropriate to, at the end, Bloom himself should become a musical instrument and join the chorus. Sea Bloom, greasy Bloom, viewed last words softly. When my country takes a place among... must be the Burgundy. Nations of the earth, known behind, she's passed. Then and not till then, tram! Yang, 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 yang. Good opportunity coming. Yang, 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 yang. Oh, God, I'm sure it's the Burgundy. Yes. One, two. Let my epitaph be written. I have done. And I have to say, I think, God, I was awful pain in my head. Oh, my God, it would be fun to die in a gallery. I would just drop on the floor. And all these, excuse me, ladies, but all these handsome young men.
What?
Oh yes, I have a new will. Yes. Anyway, the next bit that I want to do is from the Cyclops episode. In Homer's Odyssey, the Cyclops is one of a series of one-eyed giants living on the island. Ulysses and his crew land on the island. They're caught by Polyphemus, the Cyclops, and he imprisons them, and he's eating them one by one. They manage to escape, but when they're going, Ulysses has said that his name is No Man, but when he gets onto the boat again, he shouts to him, "Yeah, my name is Ulysses!" And of course the giant gets a directional find, hurls a rock and sinks the boat. But in this episode, Bloom is taunted about his Irishness, whether or not he's Irish, because like Jerry Davis, he's Jewish, and he retaliates, and they try to murder him by throwing a biscuit tin at him, which creates an explosion, the whole city is blown up. But Bloom is rescued by a deus ex machina who hoists him up from the back of a Georgian car into heaven. But I was just lowering the heel at the point, and I see the citizen getting up to wander to the door, puffing and blowing with a dropsy, and he cursing the curse of crumble on him, out of his bell, book and candle in Irish, spitting and spatting out of him, and Joe Nicola throwing like a leprechaun trying to pacify him. "Let me alone," says he. And begob as far as the door, and they hold him, and he bawls out of him, "Three cheers for Israel!" Sit down on the parliamentary stuff you're asked for Christ's sake. And don't be making a public exhibition yourself. Jesus, there's always some bloody clown or other kicking a bloody murder about bloody nothing. God, but to turn the porter sour in your guts, or it would. And all the ragamuffins of the nation and sluts round the door, and Martin telling the drabby to drive ahead, and the citizen bawling, Alf and Joe asked him to sit down and wished, and he on his high horse about the Jews, and the loafers calling for a speech, and the loafer with a patch over his eyes starts singing, "If the man in the moon was a Jew, Jew, Jew," and a slut shouts out of her, "Hey, mister, your fly is open, mister," and says he, "Mendelssohn was a Jew, and Karl Marx, and Marco Dante, and Spinoza, and the Saviour was a Jew, and his father was a Jew, your God." "He had no father," says Marx, who's a bit of a theologian. "That old Jew now, drive ahead." "Who is God?" said the citizen. "Well, his uncle was a Jew," says he. "Your God was a Jew, Christ was a Jew like me." God, the citizen made a dash back into the shop. "Why, Jesus, is he? I'll brain that bloody Jew man for using the holy name. By Jesus, I'll crucify him, so I will. Give us that biscuit box here." You've never seen the light of it in all your born off. Go gone if he got that lovely ticket in the side of his pony to remember the gold cup, so he would. But be gone, the citizen would be mad for salt and battery, and Joe for aiding and abetting. The Jarvie saved his life by furious driving, as sure as God made Moses. Oh, Jesus, he did. And he let a volley of oaths out after him. Did I kill him today, or what? And the last we seen was a bloody car round the corner, and old sheep face up on it gesticulating, and the bloody monger after him with his lugs well back, for all he was bloody well worth, to tear him limb from limb. 100 to 5. Jesus, he took the value of that out of him, I can tell you. When lo, there came about them all a great brightness, and they beheld the chariot wherein he stood ascend to heaven, and they beheld him in the chariot, clothed upon in the glory of the brightness, having raiment as of the sun, fair as the moon, and terrible that for all they durst not look upon him. And there came a voice out of heaven calling, Elijah, Elijah. And he answered with a main cry, Abba, Adonai. And they beheld him, even him, Ben, Bloom, Elijah, amid clouds of angels, ascend to the glory of the brightness at an angle of 45 degrees, of a gentleman whose little bit is like a shot off of a shovel. The last bit is going to make down. She's a sex on the strand. Joyce faced this on the episode where the princess Nausicaa, with her handmaidens, are rattling out the clothes, and Odysseus, Ulysses, is washed up on the shore, naked as a jaybird. But always a gentleman, he covers the organs of generation with his hands, and she's so charmed and enraptured by this conversation that they fall in love. Now, in this episode, Joyce chooses Gertie MacDowell, a kind of lower middle class girl who's addicted to romantic fiction, and he develops a style which he described as a namby-pamby, jammy, marmalady, drawsy style, with effects of incense, stew cockles, and masturbation. Quite a heavy brew, I'm sure you agree. And Joyce got his family to send him over copies of all these kind of Mills and Booney kinds of romances, and Gertie's favourite is an evanescent little piece called, which was published monthly, called The Princess's Novelette. It has vanished from history. There isn't a copy of it left, except this, which I bought in the newsagent's shop at the corner of this road. And just to give you an example of the kind of thing Joyce is basing this style on, here is the monthly story. It's called Sweet Mistress Prue by Alice Gunter, author of The Great Thin Blue Line, etc., etc., etc. Chapter 1. Hark, hark! The lark at heaven's gate sings, as Phoebus gins arise, his steeds to water those springs, on chaliced flowers that lies, and winking maybuds gin to ope their golden eyes, with everything pretty been, my lady sweet, arise, arise, arise. 5 o'clock in the morning, and a fair, sweet, girlish face, with the unsullied lilies and roses of youth and perfect health, peeped out the open window on a sweet spring morning. She tossed back her bonny brown hair that waved about her low, broad forehead. Her eyes were of that purpley blue seen only on the velvety petals of pansies. And her mouth was so kiss-worthy that one did not wonder to see butterflies hover about it as about the honey sweet dew of a flower. Well, as the Kinks used to say, seeing in their 60s, I'm not the world's most masculine man, but even I could detect the presence of female pulchritude in the vicinity, if it was accompanied by hordes of intersex trying to get into the available orifice. Now, to find it, yes. So, first of all, what Joyce does is he turns it into an evening on the strand for a gorgeous day of playing with children. And there's a firework display going on in the background. And there's also the men's temperance sodality of the Blessed Virgin Mary in a Star on the Sea church. And it all gets mixed up. You know, and even though masturbation, Bloom has an orgasm, close your ears, children. You never get a whisper of an orgasm. This is all done through the objective correlative of a firework display. So watch out, rockers. The Sally began to fold around his mysterious embrace. Far away in the west, the sun was setting, and the last glow of all too fleeting day lingered lovingly on sea and strand, and the proud promontory of dear old Hope, guarding as ever the waters of the bay. On the wind-grown rocks of Blonde Sandemount shore, and last but not least, on the quiet church, whence there streamed forth at times upon the silvers, the voice of prayer to her who is in her pure radiance, a beacon ever to the storm-tossed of my heart of man, Mary, star of the sea.
Queen of angels, queen of patriarchs, queen of prophets of all saints, they pray, queen of most holy rosary. And then Father Conroy handed the funeral to Canon O'Hanlon, and he put in the incense and sensed the blessed sacrament, and Sissy Catholic caught the chick twins, and she was itching to give them a wrinkled clip on the ear, because she thought he was watching her. He never made a bigger mistake in all her life, because Gertie could see, without looking up, that he never took his eyes off of her. And then Kenneth O'Hanlon handed the curable back to Father Conroy and knelt down looking up at the Blessed Sacrament, and the choir began to sing Tantum Ergo, and she just swung her foot in and out in time as the music rose and fell to the Tantum Ergo Scroll Sacramentum. Three and eleven she gave their stockings in Sparrow St. George, Susan on Monday, or the Tuesday before Easter, and there wasn't a brat on them, and that was what he was looking at, transparent, not at her insignificant ones, that she cover, because he had eyes in his head to see the difference for himself. And Jackie Caffrey shouted, look, there was another, and she leaned back, and the garters were blue to match on account of the transparent, and they all saw it and shouted, look, look, there it was. And she leaned back ever so far to see the fireworks. And there was a soft thing flying about through the air, soft, to and fro, dark. And she saw a long Roman candle going up over the crowd. And in the tense hush, they were all breathless with excitement as it went higher and higher. And she had to lean back more and more to look up after it, high, high, almost out of sight. And her face was suffused with a divine and entrancing blush from straining back. She would fain have cried out to him chokingly, held out her snowy slender arms to him to come, to feel his lips laid on her white brow, the cry of a young girl's love, a little strangled cry, wrung from her, that cry that has rung through the ages. And then a rocket bang, bang, shut blind. It was like a sigh of, oh, the Roman candle burst, and then everyone cried, oh, oh, in raptures, and it gushed out of it, a stream of rain gold hair threads, and they shed, and ah, they were all green, dewy stars falling, with golden, oh, so lively, oh, so soft. Congratulations to the Olivier Cornet Gallery for this wonderful exhibition. I hope you'll excuse me because this is the annual garden party of St. Patrick's Cathedral. So I'm going to whiz over there and hope to get Evensong. I sneak in the back and then offer strawberries and cucumber sandwiches and green garden. So there we are. Have a wonderful day. It's lovely to meet some old friends and some new friends I've been corresponding with, neighbours, and even the Trinity student. But next, you're finished now.
Well finished.
Oh, good for you. And your lovely girlfriend. Or your mother.